Okay. Let's start on the chapter 8. And before we go to chapter 8, let's go back to visit what we have from the chapter 1. On the chapter 1, we're talking about the axial load and the structural member that we consider is the two force member, and the stress occur on the two force member is normal stress, sigma equal to the force, normal force divided by A. And at this chapter, we also talking about the connection, usually is the pin. And we talking about the dielectric that occur in the connection is going to be the dielectric stress equal to the dielectric force divided by the area. Okay, and then when we come to the chapter 2, that's talking about the normal strain and talking about the shear strain, it's not involved with chapter 8. And then on the chapter 3, we're talking about the mechanical property of the material and the behavior of the material. And then we come to the chapter 4. On the chapter 4, we use this equation is the Hooke's law. And then we put the relationship between the stress and the strain, and we rewrite this equation to determine the deformation of the structural member is going to be PLOAE. And we didn't use chapter 3, chapter 2, chapter 3, chapter 4 in this chapter 8. Let me elicit. And then we come to the chapter 5. Sometimes when the structural member is kind of a sharp, we also need to consider the chapter 5 is talking about the torsion. We have the shear stress due to the torsion is equal to the torsion times the radius divided by the J. But most of the time, the structural member that we have in the old examination has the section of rectangular, has the section of the I, or has the section of the T, or even has the section of the C. So this kind of structural section do not subjected to the torsion. So most of the time we didn't use this equation. So if the problem involved with the torsion, I will come back and teach you guys about that more. And then we come to the chapter 6. That's talking about the bending. Bending occur in the beam and in the frame, okay, and in the structural, what so called a three dimensional structural member. And the bending caused the normal stress of my over I, moment times the distance y divided by the moment of inertia. This one of the important equation. And then we come to the chapter 7. That's we talking about the transverse shear force that come with the bending moment in the beam and in the frame structure. And that's produce the tau equal to VQ over IT. And from the previous lecture, we did conclude that at least three equations are important. The axial normal stress, the fractional normal stress, and the transverse shear stress. And most of the time, we're going to talking about the beam, the frame, and also the two force member. If you go back to take a look on the example. And then I asked you to draw the stress distribution across all of this kind of member. If you won't understand it, you start by remember it and then try to find the value of the stress and plot the stress distribution. You will understand it. Okay. And then the problem that's involved it with the examination, problem one is going to be what we have discussed, but one can be two dimension, another one can be in three dimension. Today, I will revisit the three dimensional problem and then later on the two dimensional problem. So I will finish the problem number one. When I finish this one, we may have a break and then we go to the problem number two for our final examination. We're going to talking about the stress transformation. Transformation. The stress that we have from the problem number one can be, just generally, can be sigma sub x, sigma sub y, and also the tau sub xy. But for this problem number two, the stresses sigma sub x, sigma sub y, and tau sub xy are given. Okay, they may give you the stress element as show you over there. And then you got to read, okay, the value of stresses. And then we will have the equation. That's not convenient. they are inconvenient, the equation for the stress transformation. But we will use what's so-called MORH, more circle, to do the stress transformation. And we will review the equation for the stress transformation first to get some idea about the stress transformation. And later, next lecture, we will concentrate on this. And it require you to understand the equation. So this lecture, today lecture, is very important. We're going to review problem number one, and we're going to pave the way to the problem number two. So let's start it. The learning objective, there are different kinds of structure, not only the full force member, the beam and the frame. Not only this, there is the structural member such as the thin wall pressure vessel, okay, such as the natural gas tank over here. This is going to be in Thailand. We call it CNG tank, okay? We put the natural gas with very high compression into this tank. It's like you put the wind bowl into the balloon, okay? The balloon will get bigger, bigger, bigger. When the balloon get bigger, the surface of the balloon get the tension, okay? It's going to be in tension. And in engineering, we can draw the stress element in the surface of the balloon like this, okay? And the surface is in tension. What is going to be the stress occur over here? Okay, that's going to be something that we're going to interested to give you the equation, but usually it won't be the examination. But important, practically, you got to know it. And also, if you go to the eastern part of Thailand, there is a big ball like this. That is the portion, like a ball that you play in the field, like a football or volleyball, okay? It's going to be a big ball. And then that's also contain the compression due to the natural gas is going to be the reserve. And then this kind of structure also get the tension at the surface of the structure. Let us just go through it. Just know what is going to be. And let me give you the equation over here. We will prove this later. The tension over here will be the pressure times the radius divided by 2 times of the thickness. And for the ball, the pressure on both sides, they are the same. However, if you come to the cylinder, okay, or to the structure such as the pipe, the stress occur in this direction going to be PR over T, which is 2 times larger than the stress in this direction. The stress in this, sorry, I do some mistake on this. Let me last. This is going to be PR over T, and this is going to be PR over 2T. This called the longitudinal stress. Okay, that is going to be PR over 2T. And this is going to be the hoop stress. That is going to be the stress on the tangential direction of the surface of the tank. And by knowing this stress, I will point to the application of the knowledge of the stresses in the thin wall pressure vessel for some example later. And then we are going to work on the 2D and 3D structural member subjected to the combined loading with 2 examples that I will show you later. So first, come to take a look at this structure. There are a lot of structure that's subjected to what's so called the combined loading. For example, there is the weight of this plate on the structure, and it's going to be the weight of this portion of the structure, and also the weight of this beam, even though there is the weight of the column along its length. Okay, this load called the vertical direction load, and most of the time it can be the weight of the structure. Okay, and then there is another portion of the load such as the wind. Okay, in a windy day, the wind can reach 60 or 50 kilometer per hour. If you like to prove the force of the wind like this, it's going to occur in the horizontal direction. Just drive your motorcycle 100 kilometer per hour, and you will see when the wind passes into your face, you will feel the force. Okay, this kind of external loading causes the external stress to the structure, supposed to be chapter 1, and causing the tau equal to TR over J. Okay, that's I did show you guys previously this equation. I like you guys be able to remember all of this important equation, because later all these stresses will be combined into the stress element. Okay, that's going to be the first thing you got to be able to solve for. There are 3 problems, sorry, only 2 problems on the homework. Okay, just do it again. Let us visit the thin wall pressure vessel. The ME student going to use this knowledge, because at least you got to know how to install the CNG tank into the car or the bus. Okay, the pressure vessel is a structural member used to carry the pressure from the food is at the gas, maybe the CNG or the LPG tank. Okay, this liquid petroleum gas, you may find it in the kitchen of your house. Okay, but this one, you may find it in the backside of the car. This kind of petrol vessel, when you like a children, okay, you have pay with the balloon. Okay, when you blow this balloon, the balloon will go bigger and bigger and bigger. The surface of the balloon will get tension, and the tension in the balloon can cause sigma sub x and sigma sub y. The tensile stresses occur on the surface of the balloon is the normal stress. Okay, due to the shape of the balloon is not circular or it's not cylinder, so the stresses over here is a little bit hard to determine, but we can assume the stress over here in the form of the stress in the surface of the ball. And most of the time, this kind of tank, okay, can be modeled as the one shown over here. And this kind of tank will have the radius R. Okay, like this one, the radius, if you measure here, is maybe 1 meter. And the thickness of the tank, the T, usually is very small, such as over here, it can be 5 millimeter, or it's gonna be 5 × 10⁻³ meter. So usually the thickness is very small. By doing this, we have the R over T ratio of 1,000 divided by 5. That is going to be 200. This kind of tank that has very thin wall like this, okay, has the ratio of R over T larger than 10. By doing that, the surface of this tank will very thin as the surface of the balloon. So the important stress that occur will be only sigma sub x and sigma sub y, and the stress is in tension. Okay, and what going to be the stress that occur on this material point of the tank? Okay, you may say this is the real thing. This is going to be the model. When you put the pressure into the tank will be get bigger, trying to get expanding in the longitudinal. It's going to get longer. Okay, so in the longitudinal, you get this sigma 2, and in the another direction, this is sigma 1. They keep this stress because if you refer the stress over here, sigma 2 is in the y direction. If we consider this element, this is going to be sigma sub y. Okay, and sigma 1 is in c direction. By doing this, if you reference it to the XYZ axis, this is going to be sigma sub c. However, if you consider the element over here, the stress in this direction is going to be sigma sub y, but there is the tangential or hoof stress. This is going to be in this direction. Now, this is going to be sigma sub x. So in general, you may call the stress this one as the longitudinal stress. For this one, they call it sigma 2, and this one is the hoof stress or tangential stress. This is called sigma 1. by doing this, just let's call this hoop stress. This is going to be longitudinal stress. What's going to be the function of this? Okay, it's going to be cut. You're going to cut this portion, just cut at the half of it. This is going to be another half. And then when you cut this one, you will get this section. This section is only D sub Y when you cut it. And then for the curve that's shown over here, okay, that is the curve that's shown over here. You may draw this portion that is going to be the material of the tank, okay, and this one also has this portion. So it's a kind of, you get a link, you get a link, and then you just cut it like this one. You just cut this link by a half. Let me get my projector. So you get this kind of portion. Okay, must be something like this. And there is the pressure. The pressure will act to this link. Actually, it's act along the curve. And the resultant of this pressure will be equal to what act on this vertical surface. Okay, and then when the pressure acts on this one, the top and the bottom portion of the link will also resist that stress by doing that. If you understand the physical meaning of that, physical meaning of that, for the thin wall tank, the stress will uniformly distributed on this thickness, okay? And this going to be this sigma one, like I told you, is going to be in this direction, and it's going to be in this direction in order to taking care of the stresses due to, take care of the pressure that act on this portion. What act on this curve can be considered only act on this portion. So the pressure over here is P, okay? And the pressure P will time, we have stress equal to P over A. So P equal to stress time A, or P equal to the pressure, P, maybe P sub O or small p time A. So by doing this, this is D sub Y, and this is 2R, okay? The area over here is 2R time D sub Y, and the force is going to be 2R time D sub Y time P, and it's going to be, and it's going to be equal to the sigma one that act on this yellow area. And this yellow area is going to be T time D sub Y. And there is two of them. So you have two over here and then time sigma one. When you get this one, you may cut, okay, by this one, rearrange this equation, you get the hoop stress to be PR over T. Okay, that's I showed you guys before, the stress, the stress over here is going to be PR over here. And then we come to determine the longitudinal stress, just go the same way, but this time we're going to cut the tank in this direction. Now, what we have, the pressure that act in the tank, the pressure that act allow this tank. Okay, the pressure P going to time this area. This P act on this area. This area is going to be pi r square. Okay, and then the material will resist this pressure and is going to act along the circumference of the tank, and this going to be the stress in the longitudinal direction. We call longitudinal stress, and the area is going to be 2 pi r. That is going to be the circumference, and then time t. So you get the area over here as the area of the material of the tank, such as the steel. So you got 2 pi r, and then time t, and then time sigma 2, and then you get it equal to p time pi r square. Now you get the longitudinal stress, half of the boob stress, because it is pr over 2t, the pressure times the radius divided by 2 times of the thickness. So we have 2 stress already. Ajahn, if we consider clearly, the tank also subjected to the pressure that's at perpendicular to the surface, which we call it the radial stress, is going to act like this, or act like this, or act like this. The direction of this stress, we may call it sigma sub 3 as the radius. This stress going to be very small. This is going to be the pressure P. Okay, so the sigma 3 is going to be the pressure P on the inner surface. However, when we talking about the outer surface, we may talking about the surface over here. For the outer surface, there is no pressure. So sigma T is equal to 0. That means sigma T reduced very quick. Okay, and then if you come back, let's see the R over T is 10 times for the thin wall cylinder. So sigma 1 is going to be 10 times of the pressure. Sigma 2 longitudinal stress going to be 5 times. So most of the time, to make the problem easier, we may not consider the radial stress. We only consider the hoop stress and longitudinal stress, because sigma T usually is significantly than sigma 1 and sigma 2. And like I show you, typically the R over T can be 1000 millimeter divided by thickness of 5. That is going to be 200 times, such as the steel tank. Okay, and then this is going to be very large. That's sigma 1 is going to be 200 times of the P. Sigma 2 is going to be 100 times of the P. The practical problem, the ratio of sigma 1 and sigma 2 may be 100 or 200. Sigma 1, 200. Sigma 2, 200 times of the pressure that you put into the tank. Okay, and then what's going to be the application of this? Let us take a look at this problem. Why the welding joint of the liquid petroleum tank that we found it in the kitchen of our mom always do it in this direction? Why don't they will keep in this pink direction come to what we have from the previous knowledge. This is going to be the whole stress, and the stress in this direction is going to be sigma 1 equal to PR over T. Okay, if you have the radius of this one to be 200 millimeter, and the thickness of this one is only 5 millimeter. So the ratio of R over T is going to be 200 divided by 50. And then, no, it's 5 millimeter. And 5 divided by, it's going to be the ratio of the 40. So this kind of LPG tank is going to be thin wall, okay, tube or thin wall pressure vessel. And by doing this, the hoop stress sigma 1 equal to PR over T. And then you also has the stress in this direction that's going to be longitudinal stress sigma 2 equal to PR over 2T. And you can see if you put the pressure into this one based up on this, you will get this one to be 20 times P. And for this one, the hoop stress is larger, it's going to be 40 P. When you put the pressure, what is going to be the stress that's caused the failure of the tank is going to be this black hoop stress. So if you weld the structure in this pink direction, your LPG tank will not storm as you weld it in this direction, because in the pink direction, the material taking care of the hoop stress. Okay, and if you weld in this direction, okay, the longitudinal stress will apply to the welding joint. And then since this is small, so it's safer to put the stress in this circular, to put the welding joint in the circumferential direction. And then come to the problem that we have in the compressed natural gas. This of export CNG fuel tank occurred in South Korea many years ago. And this is the tank, okay? When we put the stress element over here and put the same knowledge that we have, the stress over here is going to be longitudinal stress. That is going to be PR over 2T. The stress in this direction is the hoop stress or circumferential stress. This is going to be sigma 1 equal to PR over T. And see, the crack occur by sigma 1. That's the thing that we learn from the real situation, okay, that occur in South Korea many years ago, and that's caused big damages to the tank. This is the knowledge that we can apply for this. And then we may come to petroleum industry. Sometimes we just put the natural gas. We pump natural gas from the Gulf of Thailand to Rayong, okay, and put it into a spherical vessel or the ball-shaped vessel. Why? Typically, the shape of this natural gas container is in the ball-shaped direction. If you cut this ball, you may see only the stress sigma 2 occur in the ball, since the ball is in what's so-called symmetry in all direction. That's why the stress in all direction of the balls are equal. Okay, like this one. And the same thing. If you consider this portion, the inside of the spherical vessel will subject it to the pressure P with the area of pi r squared. And then the steel outside of this ball will resist the pressure causing sigma 2 with the area of 2 pi r, okay, times t. And then you get the same equation for the cylindrical tank when you cut it in the normal direction of the longitudinal. And then you get this one, Pr over 2t. So the stress in the spherical vessel is going to be smaller than the stress in the hoop stress of the cylindrical compression tank. And by doing this, that's what the advantage of this spherical vessel compared to the cylindrical vessel. So most of petrochemical industry use this kind of spherical vessel to store the compressed natural gas. Okay, that's the knowledge, the whole knowledge that we have. This is the example, okay, from the Thai metal company who produced this spherical tank for the petroleum industry over there. Now, we come to our same thing. We're going to have sigma equal to P over H over A, M equal to MY over I, and then tau equal to VQ over IT. This kind of three problem will involve with this kind of structure. What is going to be the calculation procedure? Okay, so come back to what we have in the engineering static. Before we can determine the internal axial force, internal bending moment, internal transverse shear, you got to use the knowledge from engine static. Problem number one. Problem number three require this knowledge. So go back and try to work on that own knowledge. So we will start by drawing the free body diagram, okay? And that diagram is for the beam in this example. And then we will use the equation, okay, to find reactions. Most of the time, the two-dimensional problem, most of the time, the 2D problem will start here. So you must put, again, review kit, the reference axis here. And then just say this is 10 kilonewton. So next, after you set up the reference axis and the free body of the beam, just put the no force into the position. And then you may see if you take the moment over here, the 10 kilonewton will provide the rotation in the clockwise direction. So the cable will produce the tensile force or the tension to resist the rotation of the applied force. And also you will get this one, the next step, this one, let's say this is A, this is B, A sub X, and then A sub Y. and did T sub B. By using the equation of equilibrium, you will find, actually, you will start by finding the T sub B first. You're going to take the moment at A. Okay, let's say this is 1 meter, 1 meter, 1 meter. And I will let you guys to go back and take a look at this one. This is 30 degree. And then after you get the T sub B, you later will find the A sub X and A sub Y. And then the A sub X and D sub Y will be result in the R sub A. If you go back to chapter one, you got to use tau equal to V over A to determine the shear stress at the pin at A. Okay, and now you got to next, what's going to be the stress occur at the middle of this portion of the beam? That is going to be the second step. You got to draw the free body diagram of the portion of the beam. And then we're going to use equation to find this one, internal forces and internal moment. So it's up to you which portion you are planning to use. You may use one in this direction, or you may use one in this direction. I like to remind you guys that if you use this one, let's say this is going to be 0.5, this is 1 meter. This is going to be 0.5, this is 1 meter. You just copy the applied loading that you get. This is A sub X and A sub Y. And then there is going to be the moment, okay, the shear and the normal force. I like you guys to use the psi convention to determine them, and based upon what we have from the third law of Newton, okay, you also can determine the shear, the end, and then the moment, okay, by using this portion. So it's up to you guys to work on it. But when you select the point that you going to draw the stress, for example, over here, okay, you may see this top portion going to get the compression from the moment. Let's see the end. Actually, this is going to be negative. It's going to be the produce the compression also. So this one will subjected to the compression. And then I should point to you that the stress over here going to point downward. So this is going to be the normal stress. So the next step that we are going to do, we're going to find the stresses. You're going to use this 1, 2, and 3 equation, or sometimes you got to draw the stress distribution. I like you guys to go back to review the previous video clip about the stress distribution. And then the fourth, you're going to draw the stress element that I did show you guys over here. That is going to be a material point on the structure, okay? And then from this one, we finish our problem number one. Actually, in the problem number two, we will use this stress element to do the stress transformation. But the problem is going to be very complicated. So in the problem number two, we will give you, okay, this one. Because if not, when you make a mistake on the problem number one, it will make you get the wrong answer for the problem number two also. So they are independent. Now, by doing this, just follow the word over here. I should point out, when you did combination of the stresses over here, we will follow what the equation, a number of equations that we have over here. And then most of the time, the main equation again going to be these three equations. But if we have the circular section, okay, that is going to be the structure such as the shaft. Sometimes it requires you to use this equation again. If the problem will come with the shaft, I will come to teach you again. And then when you combine the stress, you use the principle of superposition. So by doing this, you got to check the important thing. Based upon this, the stress occur on the structure must be in the linear elastic portion. And then the deformation going to be very small. That is going to be the requirement of this one, okay? And then I like you guys to go back and work on this problem by your own. What is going to be the first step that's going to draw from this free body diagram, and then you use the equation to determine, to find this one, to find internal forces and internal moment. So go back. How do you get this going to be the axial force? This is going to be the moment. And this axial force will produce this axial stress. And then since 15,000 Newton is in compression, you get the normal stress of 3.75 megapascal. For the moment of 700,000 Newton meter, this can be 700 Newton meter, okay, if you use in the meter. And this portion going to be in compression due to the head of the arrow point on this portion. And then this going to be in compression. This compression going to combine with this compression is going to produce the resultant stress of 15 megapascal. But when we move to this portion is going to be in tension by combine with this one. You got to minus 11.25 with 3.75. So in final, you get this going to be 7.5. And this is going to be 15 megapascal. So the stress on this portion is going to be larger than the stress in this portion based upon we have discussed from the previous lecture. Okay. Actually, the distance here and here must be equal. If I remember is correct, this one can be 100 millimeter. Okay, this is going to be no the total of 100. This is 50 millimeter, and this is 50 millimeter. But when the stress change to this one, the point of this zero stress going to move from this one to this one. Okay, since the stress, the triangular over here, the green angular and the red angular, they are the same, so the slope is going to be the same. You can determine the location here of x by putting 100, the total of the 100 minus the x, and then compare the slope 7.5 divided by x. 7.5 divided by x equal to 15 divided by 100 minus x. So the new location of the neutral axis, the green one, the yellow one, will be obtained. Like you guys to go back and trying to work it on yourself. I have more important problem over here. The frame is subjected to 100 kilonewton. This is going to be the three dimensional problem. It's going to be harder. We are going to draw the stress of stress occur at this point B. This point B is 100 millimeter measure from the back, and it's going to be this length. You're going to cut this one. This is going to be 300. Why notice this is 600 minus 200 minus 100. This is going to be 300. So we're going to cut this portion of this frame. And by using the knowledge from the engineering graphic, you may draw the picture of this one in three dimension. So on the bottom portion of this frame, you may connect the line and you get the portion like this. Then what the 80 come from? When you distribute the 100 kilonewton in the vertical direction, that is going to be 100 times this is 4, this is 5, that is going to be 80. When you project it in the horizontal direction, it's going to be times 3 divided by 5. This stress, how is going to apply to this portion of the section? Before you can do that, you got to consider the top portion of this frame. Okay, this top portion, the free body diagram of the top portion of the frame, and use the equation of equilibrium to phi nvm. Okay, you can draw the free body diagram of the top portion in two ways. One, you may draw it in three dimension. That's going to be very tough, but most of the time, due to the symmetry, okay, due to the symmetry, the force applied like this, we may draw this top portion in the two dimension. Based upon this, you just draw the line over here, and then over here, and then over here on the top, and then over here, and then you just connect over here. And the last one, this portion, just copy this portion over here. And based upon this, this is going to be the point, okay, at the mid length of this one. That is going to be 150 millimeter. Just put this portion together in order to get this axis. And the element that you are consider is over here. So actually, your element going to be on the top or on the bottom, or just get to know it's going to be here. And then this is going to be 300. It's going to be 100 plus 200. And the total over here is going to be 500. We may have this one for 500. And then this one is going to be 200. This one is going to be 200. Since this is 200 and this is 300, we get this one for 100. So we get this one for 100. And then this is 500. This is 300. You get this one for 200. Now, the applied force, 60, is going to be in this direction. This is going to be the 60 kilonewton, and this is going to be the 80 kilonewton. The resultant force must be occur on this centroid of the section. The centroid of the section passing to this neutral axis. Actually, it's not neutral axis in this area. Let's see, it's going to be the axis that's passing to the centroid of the section. And then in reality, this force, okay, will occur on this portion like this. So let's call it N. And then the shear force, the V, must be here. And then what we have the moment due to the 60 and 80 kilonewton will be in this direction. So this one must be the moment. Okay, then we are going to use the equation of equilibrium. And then let us, based on our consideration, let's set this one is the X and this one is the Y. And then you only use the summation of F sub. Let's say Y equal to zero. So the N over here, the N over here upward is positive. N is going to be equal to 80 kilonewton. And then you come to the summation of X sub X equal to zero. This V, this is going to be positive. V is going to be equal to 60 kilonewton. Okay. And then what we have, the moment, you just do the summation of the moment, summation of the moment equal to zero. Take the moment over here. So M over here, M over here, M over here is positive, equal to 80, equal to 80 times the distance over here. That is going to be 0.35. And then the 60 has the line of action over here. And this is 100. And this is 100. So the line of action over here is going to be 0.2. So we get this one, 60 times 0.2. And that is going to the value of this M in Newton meter. Kilonewton meter. And then by transferring the force, the N over here will be in this direction. It's going to be 80, okay? And 60 kilonewton, use third law of Newton, you get this one. And the moment is going to be like this. So you may have this portion of this one is in compression. That means by doing this, the stress occur over here due to the moment is going to be in the tension. Okay. And then we're going to determine the stresses occur at this B point due to the 80 kilonewton force, 60 kilonewton shear force, and the bending moment of 40 kilonewton meter. So we have the next step. Just consider this one. The stress due to 80 kilonewton going to be divided by the width 200 millimeter and 300 millimeter. Sigma equal to P over A. Okay, it's going to produce the normal compressive stress like this. And this is the location of the element that we are interested in. For the 60 kilonewton, it's going to produce the transverse shear stress, the maximum going to be here. And tau max equal to 1.5 V over A. If you put it, it's going to be 1.5 times 60,000 divided by the area, 200 times 300, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. So it's going to be 1.5 megapascal for the tau max. But for the stress over here, we will determine it later what is going to be the tau over here. For the stress over here, they are equal. That is sigma equal to 80,000 Newton divided by 200 and 300 millimeter square. So it's going to be 8 divided by 6. And 8 divided by 6 is what? 8 divided by 6, 1.333. This is going to be 1.333 megapascal. Okay. And then the stress occur due to the 40 kilonewton meter. It will produce the compressive stress in this portion, and it's going to produce the tension in this portion. And then what going to be the tensile stress occur over here. Okay. And this is going to be sigma equal to M. And then the Y going to measure from here to here. For this one, 150. So Y over here is going to be 50 millimeter divided by the moment of inertia. Again, the moment of inertia is going to be the I over here. The I over here is going to be this one, 0.2 times 0.3 cubed divided by 12. So we get the I. Everything can be computed easily. Okay, and then what we have going to be the stress. I is going to be this one. And then what is going to be tau equal to VQ over IT? I is okay. The T is going to be 0.2. So this is easy. What is going to be the Q? Okay, by doing this, you got to understand that it's going to be the area here. That is 0.1, 0.1. And then time this one is going to be 0.2. And then we measure this one for this one is 50. This one for this one is half of 100. This is 50 millimeter. So this is going to be 0.1. 0.2, 0.1. And then you get this one for 1.333 megapascal. And the last one, M40 kilonewton meter, 40,000, and then 50 millimeter is here, divided by I is 4.4444. So this is going to be 4.444 kilonewton. So in the combination of these two, just minus 4.444 by 1.111, we get this stress, okay, will be 3.111. That's come from 4.444 minus 1.333. And then what we have is the shear stress. The shear stress is in this direction. So based upon this, we have the shear stress like this, 1.333 megapascal. And we have another three of the shear stress. Okay, this is 1.33 and another three. This is going to be the stress occur at point B. Okay, so we have this three-dimensional problem. I took really long time for the three-dimensional problem. Let us go again to the 2D problem. Again, we have the frame. Why they like to have the frame? Because when we have the frame, the internal forces and internal moment going to be this three. That's why. And again, the first step, draw the free body diagram, use the equation of equilibrium. I will go past this very quick, okay? And let you guys to think about the reaction that we can determine it. That's going to be the starting point. And when you get all the reaction, over here, A sub X and A sub Y, we're going to cut it, because on this problem, we like to consider the section C. Okay, you got to cut the structure over here. Then you need to draw the free body diagram of this portion. It's going to be very simple. And again, before we go further, this is the section of this section C, 50 millimeter width, 250 millimeter depth. So we may need to mean the internal forces and moment like this. And then again, the stress due to this one, normal force and the moment will combine each other. And let's see, C is going to be on the top, basis up on this one. It's rectangular. I like you guys to go back if this one is going to be the I section. So the normal stress over here is going to be 16,400 450 divided by the area. Okay, you can get this one in Mecca, Pascha. This is going to be in compassion. And again, this one will combine with the stress due to the moment. And based upon this, the moment on the top is going to be in compassion, and the stress due to the moment on the bottom is going to be in the tension, and the stress over here, they are equal. That is 32,895 Newton meter. And then you must measure downward or upward is going to be 0.125, half of 250 millimeter. And then the I is going to be 0.05 times 0.25 cubed divided by 12. So you get this one in Mecca, Pascha. Okay, and the last one that you have is the stress due to the shear. Since the C is on the top, okay, the stress distribution over here is going to be downward, and the distribution going to be something like this. So the stress over here is zero. The stress over here is zero. At the C, there is no shear stress. So the combination of this is going to be compression and compression. Based upon this, you may get the stress only in compression. This is going to be this stress combined with this compressive stress. Okay, let's go and check what do you get this answer or not. And then there are extra things. Not only this, okay, this is going to be two dimension, this is three dimension. Usually we put this is the C. And then let's us do the fractional stress distribution as before over here, shear stress over here, and this. Let's us cutting 2.C, and we has these three pictures that I did show you guys already, okay? This normal stress will combine with this bending stress. Again, on the top, you combine them together, you get the answer from the previous one. From the bottom, this is compression, this is tension. Compression, tension is 61.84. The top is 64.47. So the center axis going to the neutral axis, sorry, will move from the center axis to the new one. Let's say this is Y. Y is going to be here. So 64.47 divided by Y. This one divided by, and then get this one, 61.83 divided by this one is 250 minus Y. Okay, just use it. It's a little bit lower. Usually, this is 125 millimeter, and this one is 125. Now, it is 127.61. It's a little bit down from the centroid axis. Okay, and then you can draw any combination of the stress. For example, if, okay, you like to determine the normal stress over here, don't worry. You may see this is zero. This is going to be the normal stress at the centroid. So this is going to be minus 1.32. Okay, and if you prefer, you may use the similar triangle to determine it, 1.32 also. Okay, And then the last one, find the state of stress as the centroid, as the centroid axis and draw the stress element. So we going to draw this one. We get the normal stress at the centroid to be 1.32 compression. And the maximum shear stress, okay, usually occur on the centroid axis. And then you may determine it from 3 over 2 V over A. It's going to be 2.63. And if you ask to determine tau over here by VQ over IT, you can do it. What is going to be V? It's going to be 21,930 Newton. And the moment of inertia, okay, this is going to be the width and the depth. It's going to be 0.25 cubed over 12. And then the thickness over here is going to be 0.05. And then what's going to be the Q? The Q, that is going to be this one. You just compute this area, and that is going to be 50 millimeter. And this one half of the depth. So 0.05 times 0.125, half of 250 millimeter. And then this is the area, the moment arm of the area is going here. That is going to be half of this 0.125 divided by 2. You put everything together, you will get this one, 62.63. And over here at the new centroid axis, stress, normal stress, 0. This is going to be minus 1.32 compression. And the shear going to be in the downward direction. So we have the stress for this one, like this. That is the end of chapter. No, not yet. This is going to be what we have. Another one, they just like to determine the state of stress as 100 millimeter downward. So it's not hard from the stress distribution. And then for the normal stress, just determine what we has previously over here, okay? This is has two way. One, you may use the similar triangle 63.15 and divided by 125 millimeter. Or you have this one that you are looking for, the stress over here, sigma divided by this one. This is going to be 125 minus 100, okay? Or you may use sigma equal to M, and this Y is going to be this one, okay? 0.025 and divided by I. You put the same thing, you get the same answer, okay? And combine this one by compressive stress over here. You get the stress over here in compression. And for the tau, you're going to use this area, okay, to determine the Q. The Q is going to be 0.05, and then this is 0.05, and then this is 0.1. And then we got to measure this one to this axis. So this one is 50 and this one is 25. This one is 25. So this is going to be 0.05 0.75. That is going to be the Q. 0.05 and 0.1 and 0.75. This is V. I we have before, and T is the thickness. So we get this one has the compression like this, and this way downward on this left-hand side. This is downward, and the author gonna follow its direction like this. Okay, that is going to be the end of chapter 8, and let's break for about 3 minutes, and I will come back to the chapter 9. We come to the second problem on the final examination. On the second problem, usually they will give us the stress element, and based on the stress element, you guys must be able to reference that axis X, and this one the axis Y, and the stress, the normal stress, that is in tension in this direction, we call it sigma sub X, and then tension equivalent to positive, and also in this one is we has is like sigma sub Y, and tension is positive. Then for the shear stress, we going to reference to this reference plane, and if on this reference the shear put in the Y direction, we will have this one positive shear stress, and the author will follow by the balance of the force due to the shear stress and the moment due to shear stress. So the first big step, you got to read sigma X, sigma Y, and tau sub XY correctly. Then the stress, I will show you later. If you rotate the axis X to the X palm, when you rotate X to X palm by the counterclockwise positive theta, the Y also will be rotated with the same angle to Y bar. That is the element usually we got to draw over here, but it's going to mess up everything. So we extend it into this direction, okay? And then by doing this, our reference surface going to be the same. Since the axis change, the stress that we have previously will change. This is going to be sigma sub X palm. And then due to the stress transformation equation, the sigma sub X palm can be determined as the function of theta, sigma X, sigma Y, and tau sub XY. I will provide the equation later. And also, you also have sigma sub Y palm. Sigma sub Y palm is another function of theta and the given stresses. Okay, and we have that equation. We will use this later. And then there is going to be the shear stress. And we have this one for tau sub X palm, Y palm. Again, tau sub X palm, Y palm is going to be the function of stress. By writing this function, the problem is this function is very long equation and it's very hard to remember. Okay, remember. So the stress transformation equation is inconvenient, but we need to mention within 20 minutes to keep you the way to the Mohr circle, which is very powerful method to determine the stress transformation. Okay, and then since these stresses change with the angle theta, so this is going to be question number one. So the question number two, they're going to ask us the principal stresses. Since this stresses is the function of the theta, if you dip sigma sub x prime by d theta and put it equal to zero, by putting this one, you will get the angle theta sub p1 and theta sub p2. This called principal angle. This principal angle will produce the principal stress sigma 1 and sigma 2. This is going to be the second question. Okay. And then they ask the third question. On the third question, they ask us to determine the maximum shear. So we did tau sub x prime y prime with d theta and put into zero. What you get is going to be the theta sub s1 and theta sub s2. That is going to be the angle that's produced positive tau max and negative tau max. On the principal angle, tau equal to zero, but for this one, angle, tau is max. Tau max occur with the sigma average, which is going to be sigma x plus sigma y divided by 2. So this is going to be the third question for the problem number 2. Let us start by understanding the learning objective, what they ask you guys to understand it. Okay, and then the angle over here, the angle over here will provide us the failure plane of the structure. Most of the brittle material, such as cast iron, is failed by principal angle. However, the ductile material, such as steel and aluminum, is failed by maximum shear. This will prove easily when you go to the next class of material testing. Okay, this slide is the total thing you got to understand. And then you have some example. You just go to all of this. And this example is more comprehensive than only chapter 9. This one, very good homework, is combined chapter 8 and chapter 9 together. And then what the evidence? When we study this thing, okay, we just cut the structure and then we draw the element in the horizontal and vertical direction. We reference this one to the x and y axis. Okay, and then what we has is the crack on the structure didn't follow what did we cut, but in the reality the crack is in the inclination like this. So actually the stress element that expands the crack is not in the black shape, it's supposed to be in this purple one. That's why we're going to need to do the stress transformation to determine the real stress that caused the crack of the structure. Okay, and then we usually can be reduced from the three-dimensional stress element to this plane stress. Plane stress. Plane is mean it's going to be in the two-dimensional stress. So the stress that's stresses that we are starting our calculation will have only these three stresses. And usually we draw this one into dimension again. Sigma sub x is positive, tau sub y is positive, tau sub xy reference to this surface is going to be positive. By the positive stress, you can rotate it. When you rotate it, counterclockwise rotation is going to be positive. And then you can determine the sigma sub x prime, sigma sub y prime, tau sub x prime like this. This is the function that I said going to be something like this from the our first slide. And this is the G function. And you can see sigma x, sigma y, and tau sub xy, this always the given value. So actually, this sigma sub x prime, this is h, sorry, tau sub x prime y prime and sigma sub y prime is going to be the function of the theta. So this is going to be the function of theta. And then we can determine the maximum normal stress, maximum shear stress by using the calculus. And I like to point out again the angle that appear in these three equations. They are in 2 theta. And this important, when we go to the Mohr circle, the angle in the Mohr circle derived from these three equations, the angle of the Mohr circle would be 2 times the theta, and the real theta only here. But what going to use in the equation, okay, in the Mohr circle, gonna be in 2 theta, important. And then if you put theta equal to 0, you get the same answer. And the first problem, just let us rotate is 30 degrees. So theta is minus 30. Sigma x is going to be minus 80. Sigma y is going to be plus 50. Tau sub xy from here is going to be minus 25 megapascal. All of these are important. You must list these stresses and angle correctly. If not, everything going to get wrong answer. So just put everything in the equation. Okay, you can do it by yourself. Okay, put it into your calculator. You get the answer. You rotate this one clockwise, but usually you supposed to dock it over here, but you cannot dock it over here easily you will mess up everything. You extend this element into this. Okay, this is going to be sigma sub x prime. This is going to be sigma sub y prime. They are in compression, and the shear stress, you got it in a negative. So on the reference surface, it's going to point downward, okay? And then there is a differential equation. Like I told you, you may dip this one, and then you may get the principal angle. By doing this calculus, you get the principal angle. This angle will produce the maximum and minimum normal stresses. That we call principal stresses. Okay. And then by doing this, the principal angle can be 2, because this is going to be sigma 1. This is going to be sigma 2. Sigma 2 will associate with theta sub p 2. Sigma 1 will associate with sigma sub p 1. And then if you put everything together by talking, this is going to be the vertical, okay? And this one going to be the horizontal. And then the angle over here is going to be 2 theta sub p. By doing this, you get this one. This is important. This is going to be the radius of the more circle, HR, more circle. Okay, please remember it. And then the sine is going to be tau sub xy divided by this square root. The cosine is going to be this one divided by square root. If you plug it back to the tau sub x prime y prime, you get shear stress is 0 at this angle. So in the principal stresses, there is no shear stress, okay? The stress is only sigma 1 and sigma 2. And then if you plug this one into this equation, the principal stress can be computed by this one. Again, this is going to be the radius of the Mohr circle. This is going to be the point of the center of the Mohr circle. Please remember these two portions of the Mohr circle. We will talking about this later. And then when you know this rotation of sigma 1, you plug another 90 degree, you get theta sub p2. So theta sub p1 and p2 different for 90 degree. The same occur from the stress. You dip this one with respect to the theta, take it equal to 0, and then you may get theta sub s1 and theta sub s2. This one, okay, based upon equation over here, you will get the angle like this, and then you may find the theta sub s1 and theta sub s2 90 degree different. However, when we talking about theta sub s1 and theta sub p1 is 45 degree, the same thing as this one. Engineering must remember something and trying to understand it, okay? And then what we have, the sine is going to be here, the cosine of the angle will be here. And then if you put it into this equation, you may get this one is going to be the radius of the Mohr circle. Remember it, okay? This one is going to be the same thing. This is going to be the tau max. So there is the important equation first, this one, and the second, this one. And then if you put the theta into this equation, you will see tau max will occur when sigma average occur. They come together, but sigma 1 and sigma 2 will come with the tau equal to 0. Okay, and this is occur as theta sub s1 for positive tau max and theta sub s2 for negative tau max. And this one will occur on theta sub p1. This one will occur on theta sub p2. Okay, and then when you put sigma 1, sigma 2 together, you may see the difference between sigma 1 and sigma 2 can be the tau max. Okay, and then when you draw the Mohr circle, this is going to be the normal stress. This is going to be the tau. The circle is going to have the center over here. And on the this one is going to be sigma 1, 0. Tau is 0. And over here is going to be sigma 2, 0. No shear stress, 0. And what we have, this one and this one is going to be this one. This is going to be the diameter of Mohr circle. When you divide the diameter by half, you get this one as the radius. And this radius is going to be square root sigma x minus sigma y square plus tau sub xy square. Okay, and then this radius again, if you draw it downward, you will get this one positive tau max. And if you draw it over here, you get this one to be negative tau max. And then the center of the Mohr circle is here. That is sigma x plus sigma y divided by 2 and 0. This is going to be sigma average log tau max. And this one going to be sigma average plus tau max. Everything related to each other. And this picture, okay, this picture explain the first line of this chapter. They are related. And I like you guys to start by visiting this one and trying to understand what we are looking for this chapter. And then the calculation is not that hard. Again, for the stress here, sigma x is minus 20, sigma y is positive 90, tau sub xy is positive 60 megapascal. Can you use the knowledge to determine these stresses? If you make this one wrong, the problem number two, you get zero score. And then find the principal stress. Just plug everything into this equation. You got sigma 1 and you got sigma 2. And what is going to be the angle? Okay, theta sub p1, theta sub p2. Just plug everything into the above equation. But when you get, you don't know yet, it's going to be theta sub b1, theta sub b2. Until you put this one into this equation, you do the computation, you get minus 46.4. That is going to be theta sub p2. See, it's hard to use it. And then if you like to find theta sub p1, just plus 90 degrees into it, you get this one to be theta sub p1. It's not convenient to remember every equation and use it. Okay, and then you get this one for the stress element. I like you guys to be able to draw this stress element by adding static. Then the last one, find the maximum in plane shear stress. Just find this one equation. Okay, just plug everything by the sign convention, just direct, very convenient, but it's very hard to understand it. Okay, and then you may get the theta sub s and another theta sub h. Which one going to associate? Theta sub s1 will associate with positive tau max. Theta sub s2 will be the negative tau max for the Mohr circle. Explain it easily. Then plug the angle into this one. You get this one is positive. So this angle will associate with theta sub s1. Okay. And then sigma average is here. And then you can draw this one to be the stress element for the stress of maximum shear stress. This is used to predict the failure of the material such as steel or for the ductile material, okay? But this one for the stress of principal stress, that's going to be the failure of the material such as cast iron or for the brittle material, okay? And then that's all for today. The final conclusion, the stress of principal stress has no shear. The stress of maximum shear stress has the average normal stress. And theta sub S1, theta sub P2 different for 45 degree, but theta sub S1 and theta sub S2, this is different for 90 degree. The same as this theta sub P1 and theta sub P2 different for 90 degree. And then this is the end of the lecture for today. Next, we will put our knowledge, what I lecture here, into the Mohr circle. The problem is this equation and related equations are very hard to remember. It's not practical. So we will use the Mohr circle most of the time to compute it. NE will use it in the machine design, in the CE student, many courses, especially in the soil mechanics. You will use this a lot. Okay, that is the end of lecture today.